Whenever things got rough, I always remember what my father used to say.
Running a business does test a man, my son. There are ups and downs. Glorious highs, and sometimes a low that leaves you feeling defeated.
The character of a man and the character of a business are not very different, are they?
Yes. But when the chips are down, we must stand up, dust ourselves off, and motor on.
Volatility. It's a funny thing. It makes you question yourself and wonder if you've made all the right decisions.
Sure, you can question some of your decisions, but stay steadfast on your goals.
Dad always said, there are no shortcuts and no quick profits.
There are no free lunches, are there? There is only one.
Right way.
At PPFAS, we think like Rahul and his father, that volatility is a fact of running a business. And buying equity shares is like owning a part of that business. We use value investing principles to manage your money. This means we invest in the right businesses at reasonable prices and for a longer term.
PPFAS Mutual Fund. There's only one right way.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme related documents carefully.
Just like in the movies, there are sequels, and sequels are low risk. So if the first part is a hit, typically you will get some viewership for the second part. So you'll have Singham and Singham Returns, and you'll have Mission Impossible 1 and 2 and 3 and 4. The Last Race did not do too well, but we'll take a chance. We'll also have a sequel today. So this sequel has been a long time coming. In fact, a lot of people in the audience today may not have seen the first part or would have forgotten the first part by now. Reason being that the first part was in 2012. And that was in fact at a different location. We were not even at this venue. So this was, I think, 4th September 2012 or somewhere thereabouts. 5.5-6 years back. That time we had discussed valuation of insurance companies. The reason we had discussed it then was that there was interest among investors in terms of looking at insurance companies, because these were about to get listed, or there was talk of listing happening somewhere down the road. And at that point in time, you could only buy them as proxies. You could buy the holding company. So if you wanted HDFC Standard Life, you had to buy HDFC Limited. Or if you wanted Prudential ICICI Life Insurance, you had to buy the shares of ICICI Bank. Enough time has gone by. Today you have direct listings by a lot of these companies. And various people have been asking me, what now? So we had discussed a framework at that point in time. Now that these companies are listed, how do we look at them, and what are the prospects for investing in these companies? So, last time when we made this presentation, one of the feedback that I got, people either loved it or people hated it, the last presentation. And people who were sort of put off by the last presentation, the common feedback was that it was too much on the technical side. So it discussed a lot of mortality tables, it discussed probabilities, it discussed finance and discounting. We looked at the formats of the two P&Ls that insurance companies report, the balance sheet, how it differs from a typical balance sheet, and things like that. People who are interested in knowing the technical aspects can go back to the first part, which is there online, and look at it again. Video quality is poor, but still one can figure out what's happening. Today we will dive more into the specific companies that are listed and what is happening. So essentially today's thing is, one, not so technical. Number two, it builds on the last presentation and it discusses the companies that are there. So we have HDFC Standard Life Insurance Company, which is listed. Today's market cap of roughly 94,600 crores. We have SBI Life Insurance Company, 66,500 crores. We have ICICI Prudential Life Insurance Company, 51,400 crores. We have Max Financial Services, which is again mainly an insurance play, although the name is different, but it's essentially an insurance play, close to 12,000 crore market cap. Apart from these, there are other proxy plays. So if you buy Bajaj FinServ, then you get Bajaj Allianz, and you'll have some piece in Kotak Mahindra, you'll have some piece in Edelweiss, and plenty of insurance companies are listed in India. These are the ones where you have a direct investment opportunity. The fourth one we'll not discuss that much in detail, or actually we are not diving really deep into any of these, but we'll be mainly looking at the first three companies that are there. Before we get into the insurance part, we've been for a while talking about the financial sector per se and how we look at it. Broadly, the financial sector can be segregated into two parts. One is the fee-based activities, and the other is where you require your balance sheet support, or wherever there is a fund-based activity involved. So fee-based, we have looked at plenty of different kinds of companies in the past. We have looked at asset management companies. This we saw closer to the Reliance Nippon Asset Management listing. Again, another one is hitting the markets this month. HDFC Mutual Fund is getting listed. We have seen how wealth management, investment banking, stock brokerage is a fee-based activity. On the same balance sheet, you can handle more clients and earn more fee income. You won't required to keep on putting in more and more capital. We've discussed credit rating as a business separately in the past, how it's a somewhat oligopolistic kind of business where on a small balance sheet you can run a large operation. So this was one aspect. We said this was our favorite hunting ground, but the other part is also not bad. So the other part, okay, we have also discussed stock exchanges and things like MasterCard, Visa businesses, payment businesses. We said apart from these businesses, there are certain fund-based businesses. So what are the fund-based businesses? Fund-based businesses broadly are banks, NBFCs, and insurance companies. Within NBFCs, you'll have a large variety of companies specializing in different segments. You'll have mortgage companies, you'll have transport finance companies, you'll have gold loan companies, you'll have microfinance companies. So you'll have a big variety. You'll have someone focusing on consumer durable finance, for example. Some will be in multiple line of businesses. So this again is a topic for some other day. We've looked at some banks in the past. Today we are doing insurance companies, part two. Insurance companies, again, we are discussing life insurance companies. We will not be discussing general insurance business today because, for one, in India, these are segregated businesses. The companies that operate in general insurance have to be parked in a separate vehicle. So you have a Prudential ICICI Life Insurance, whereas in the general insurance, you'll have ICICI Lombard. You'll have HDFC Standard Life Insurance, and you'll have HDFC Ergo doing life general insurance. So these are separate businesses in India. There is a very small overlap. We'll probably discuss it as we go along. When we say that we like the fee-based business better than the fund-based, why do we say that? So to highlight that, let's look at the HDFC group itself. Let's look at their fee-based business and their fund-based business. So the AMC, which is about to get listed, they have filed the prospectus, they have filed their annual report for March 2018. They have a net worth of 2,160 crores as on March end. Even this actually is excess capital on the balance sheet. Statutorily, probably they require 52 crores or slightly more. 50 crores for asset management, 2 crores for PMS, and maybe if they are running some other line of businesses with regulatory capital requirement, some money for those aspects. But out of this 2,160, safely they can pay out 1,500 crores and still be running the same business. So this is not really money required on the balance sheet. They may have strategically kept it to acquire some businesses which come down the line or to go into other countries or for whatever reason. But regulation does not require them to hold so much net worth. So on this balance sheet, they run assets under management of 2,78,000 crores. And their return on equity is 33%. Now let's look at the fund-based business from the same group. So insurance, they have a net worth more than twice that of the asset management company. The assets under management which they report, or in whatever manner they have calculated, because it's complicated given that there are some unit-linked businesses, some participating, non-participating, pure risk, whatever, but this number has been taken from their own balance sheet. On 4,700 crores net worth, they run this much of AUM, and their return on equity is lower, and this after having initial losses, so after having a long gestation period. We had discussed this in the first presentation, why life insurance business is a long gestation business. For the moment, just park this thought, the net worth and the return on equity number shown here are not very accurate, and they will never be very accurate for life insurance businesses. We'll see why that is the case as we go along. So why are people excited by these businesses? Just like any business in India, you can make a macro story out of it. So in the past we have seen, let's say when we were discussing the auto industry, we saw the number of cars per 1,000 people in India and in China and Europe and USA under penetration. Same way you can make a story out of insurance. Oh, insurance as a percentage of GDP is only this much, or so many people are not covered by life insurance, and as India becomes richer, as per capita income grows, as again demonetization, so people are moving towards financial assets, gold is losing its allure, people are wanting financial assets versus physical assets, so all those stories get made out. Again, wherever there is public sector involvement, there is a story that market share will move from public sector players to the private sector players. We have seen that in telecom, we have seen that in banking, we have seen that in airlines. So that could happen in insurance as well. So that is there. Everyone knows this story. So every equity investor in India has heard this story in some context or the other. All of those contexts apply to insurance as well. So let's look at the basics as far as the insurance business is concerned. So the macro story is true. the sector is growing, the penetration levels are low, and there is potential for growth. So that is a given. I hope no one is disputing that fact in the room. The fact that the market share is shifting to private players is also true. So the red bar is the private sector and the blue bar is LIC. So what was 34% in 2006 has gone up to 56% by financial year 2018. So clearly that shift is there. Take this slide with a certain amount of caution. The market share shift will be in terms of premium paid or new policies and things like that. It will not reflect the balance sheet size. So unlike bank, where if you move, or unlike bank or a mutual fund, when you move your account from, let's say, State Bank of India to HDFC Bank, all your money moves the same minute. In insurance, if you have a running policy with LIC for past 10 years and if it is going to run for another 10 years, that money will remain with LIC. That money will not shift to the private sector players. It's only as time goes along, they get more and more share of the new policies, new business, and that's how they gain market share. So the balance sheets may not have moved to that extent. So still LIC is the big player which has all this money to throw around. So that's a separate story. So, but the shift is happening. It's real. So that is fine. However, one point which people harp on too much is that, oh, there is so much need for protection for people, saying people need life cover because what happens if they were to die or were to face an accident, what will happen to their families and their children? The insurance companies are still not actually addressing that need. If one were to really drill down and look at the underlying picture, essentially insurance is still sold and bought as an investment product, and it's like the contents are savings and investment and just the wrapper around it is that of insurance. So insurance is a very small portion of the entire package which is sold. It's a product which is sold on taglines. It is a product which is sold based on people's needs. It is not sold on rational justifications or based on numbers or spreadsheets. It is something which is like whenever you say sir utha ke jiyo, it creates a certain image in mind, connotation that you don't have to depend on anybody else for your retirement, or if you pass away, your family will not depend on close relatives for sustenance. You have provided for them. So it's sold on that emotion. And it is a push product. So in every advertisement, they keep saying it's a subject matter of solicitation and things like that, whatever that means. So it doesn't say past performance is no guarantee of the future, or it does not say mutual fund investments are subject to market risk. It says we will push the product on you. For the investor, so since it's not a protection so much, only a small portion is term insurance, which is really the protection part. So those products exist, but the share of those products in the overall scheme of things is not very large. So given that bulk of the products sold are investment products, they are actually high cost products for the consumers. They are products with low persistency. We'll check what this means. What persistency means, and effectively customers are locked into one service provider. If you don't like your mobile service provider, you have now mobile number portability. If you don't like your bank account, you can close the bank account, open it elsewhere. Insurance, you can't shift around that easily. So customers are locked in that sense. So why do we say that it's a savings and investment product more than protection? This is the breakup from HDFC Standard Life's annual report. So 54% of the products sold are what are called unit linked. Unit linked are very, very similar to mutual fund products with a small component of insurance. So it may seem that 46% at least would be risk products. No. This 46% are also investment products with a small risk portion. So they would be products like endowment products or things like that, where the customer in his or her own lifetime gets some money back. It's not risk cover where you get paid only if you die, or your family gets paid only if you die. So bulk of this is still savings and investment. Only a small portion is term insurance, effectively in the whole thing. And interesting part is, this is where unit link was almost 70% and traditional policies were just 32%. At this time and prior to these years were periods where massive amount of mis-selling happened on the ground, where people lost confidence in these products, commission levels were exceedingly high, persistency ratios were exceedingly low. And the insurance sector went through its turmoil. See how the ULIPs crashed. And again, a lot of these were equity products. So when equities were not doing well, people saw their investments eroding. And then again, now it's picked up in a more or less 50-50 kind of scenario. So pure protection or pure risk cover is only this term life, where you keep paying premium for a defined period. It may be 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. Let's say someone who's 30 years of age has a spouse and children. That person says, I will need protection for my family for next 15 years, till the time kids grow up and are independent, and till the time my other investments make me financially independent. So then this person has to pay premiums for 15 years. If that person survives 15 years, nothing is paid out from the insurance company. Same way health insurance, you pay Mediclaim premium or whatever health premium. If you don't fall ill, you get nothing back. It's not an investment product. It's pure risk cover. So these are pure protection plans. These are not very popular with agents and with insurance companies and consequently with consumers. Savings investments are the unit linked products, which we saw more than 50%, and you have traditional participating and non-participating. So I'll take a minute or two explaining participating versus non-participating. In the participating product, and you would be familiar with participating products in terms of LIC policies, which give you bonus. The policy promises a certain minimum payoff, and then depending on the returns achieved by the investment, returns achieved by the insurance company, about 90% of them are paid off to the policyholders. In terms of bonus additions. So that is a participating policy. A non-participating policy is one where benefits are defined, then the policyholder does not care what investment return has been achieved by the insurance company. They get a fixed amount as defined in the insurance contract. So, broadly, an insurance company would be doing individual savings. There are group policies which cover corporate liability for gratuity, leave encashment, superannuation, then you have all these kind of things, and plus some of these companies have subsidiaries for pension management. So, for example, HDFC Standard Life has a subsidiary which is in the pension business. Now, when people retire and they have a corpus, that corpus is given to the pension company, which is obliged to pay a pension through the life of the individual. So, why do we say persistency? So, firstly, what is persistency? Persistency means that once you sign an insurance policy contract saying I am buying this policy and I will pay annual premiums to the company for the period of the policy, if you continue paying the premium, it counts as persistency. If you stop paying premium, that is not persistency. So in insurance parlance, they calculate persistency after a defined period. Most popular periods are 30th month and 61st month, and interim also there are. So 13th month means someone pays, someone signs up for a policy, pays the first premium and then pays the second premium as well when it becomes due after 1 year. Surprisingly, when 100 policies are sold, only 87 pay the second premium, 13 lapse after the first year itself. So the first year premium goes towards marketing expenses, commission, expenses of the insurance company and so on. And then a policyholder does not come back to the company at all. That is one statistic. This is from HDFC Standard Life. 61st month means after 5 years. After 5 years, about half the policyholders go missing. They stop paying premium, just like that. That's it. So what is it? Is it charity to the insurance company or to the agents or what? So this has been the troubling part about the insurance business. And again, anecdotally, a lot of it is due to mis-selling, or at least was due to mis-selling. People would be told by the agents that this is a single premium policy, saying, okay, you have 10 lakhs to invest, fill this form, give me a check for 10 lakhs and we will invest your money. The client, trusting the agent, filled out the form, wrote a check and gave the check. Now, after 1 year, insurance company went back and said, give me another 10 lakhs. He said, what 10 lakhs? I have done a single premium. Whereas later on, they realized it was an annual premium contract which has been sold to them. So they did not have money to purchase that. Again, a lot of people thought this is a guaranteed return product. They were sold ULIPs with market risk. So although my opinion may be biased to a large extent, but I think mutual fund as a product is far better regulated than insurance products, and SEBI as a regulator has been far more proactive in consumer interest as compared to IRDA. So again, biased opinion since we are in the mutual fund space, but if you read newspaper accounts in financial dailies, there are a lot of these stories which are reported, and this is why the whole bullish scenario where under penetration, so many people will come into the fold. On ground, actually, in execution, there are some slips which happen. So far, it's been more from the customer point of view. So as a customer, maybe it's not that great a product, because as a customer from insurance companies, you should look for term insurance and health insurance rather than savings and investment products. But leave that aside for the time being. Here we are gathered here to look at investment opportunities. Even though it may not be so great for investors, for consumers, are these businesses great investments for us as shareholders? We will dive into that. One thing at the outset, let's be clear, of the long list of insurance companies in India, focus on the top few. Don't look at a broad set of players. So look at companies like HDFC Standard Life, look at companies like SBI Life, look at companies like ICICI Prudential. Now if it's a very small outfit, or if it's a company with not too much traction, those companies should not be looked at for investment purposes. Reason being that in this business, there are huge scale advantages. The largest player has multifold advantages over the smaller players. That is not the case in other activities like, let's say, stock brokerage or investment banking or mutual funds. But that is very true in insurance. We'll take a look at the reasons why. So one, you should stick with players which have huge amount of brand recall. HDFC is already entrenched in people's mind. SBI is already entrenched in people's mind. ICICI is already entrenched in people's mind as a retail brand. Now, a random name, let's say Edelweiss Tokyo. Nothing against Edelweiss or Tokyo Life Insurance, but it's not as retail a brand as a SBI, which has been around in the country for maybe 100 years. If it's a relatively new brand, the company has to spend a lot of time and effort in terms of popularizing the brand. And again, the fact that it's an emotional product, and it's a product where you are relying on some third party to take care of your family after your death. You want a player which will be around for a long time. And to that extent, government ownership gives some tangible or intangible benefit to those players. So despite LIC doing all sorts of things on its investment side, LIC is seen as a government body, SBI is seen as a government body. If it's a very new player, people will say, oh, I haven't even heard about this company 3 years, 5 years back. Will this big company be around 10 years from now, 20 years from now? So whether this is said explicitly or not, somewhere they have this small disadvantage. And I've anecdotally seen insurance agents badmouth the new players, saying, "Arey, wo company hoga ke nahi pata nahi, baad mein aap LIC product le lo ya aap SBI product le lo." That is the kind of pitch that happens on the ground by some of the players. Again, since this is a large push product, if you have your affiliate bank, relationship managers, branch managers pushing your product, it's a huge, huge advantage over someone who does not have a distribution network. So stick with players with a retail bank affiliation or something like that. Again, HDFC, ICICI, SBI kind of thing, rather than someone who does not have that kind of a reach. Again, the management should be good, which we say in all companies. The reason why this holds true is that insurance is a very, very high fixed cost business. See, let's compare it with mutual fund business. Now, mutual fund business, to to a large extent works on outsourced activities. So the entire industry is broadly serviced by two large registrars, CAMS and CARMI. So whether you have HDFC mutual fund unit or a ICICI mutual fund unit or a Reliance mutual fund unit or a DSP BlackRock or whichever funds, you will either go to CAMS or CARMI. There are two others which are there, Sundaram and Templeton, but broadly these are the two large registrars. So a mutual fund need not set up these many branches. Again, custodian activities is outsourced, fund accounting is outsourced, a lot of things happen outside the organization. In the insurance space, each insurance company sets up a countrywide network of branches, spends a lot of money training its branch employees, training its agents and all of that. Again, typically agents will sell one insurance company products. You will not have situation where one agent is selling 5, 7, 10 insurance company products. So again, there is this duplication of each company having to set up its own agent network. So given that it's a high fixed cost business, objective of the insurance company should be to spread that cost over more number of policies. Now if there is company A which is spending 100 rupees and company B which is spending 100 rupees, both on fixed cost, if the first company has only one policy, that one policy has to bear 100 rupees. If the second company has 100 policies, then the cost per policy will be only one. So the profitability for the second company will be that much higher, given that it has scale. So in the insurance space, scale is a huge advantage. In the mutual fund space, by contrast, a very small scale is a disadvantage, a very large scale is a disadvantage. Very small because of fixed cost, same argument. Very large because investment performance suffers. In the mutual fund space, somewhere in the middle is the right approach. Here the largest companies will benefit the most. So people who are scale players are actually seeing good growth on the ground. So all the companies that we saw are exhibiting traction. They have come out of the gestation period, now they are showing profits and return on equity. Although they are not as attractive as fee-based businesses, but they are decent businesses. So although they are not as great as AMCs in terms of return on equity, but one advantage that insurance has over, let's say, a fund business is that it's not so prone to cycles, up and down cycles, especially the stock market cycle. Despite all the newspaper headlines, in a severe bear market, the fees of the AMCs will suffer, the inflows will stop, mutual fund products can be redeemed very, very quickly. You can press a button on your mobile phone app and redemption is done, or fill a simple form and redemption is done. Insurance are long dated contracts. The money which you have already put in is locked in, plus you are committed to go on giving them money over next 10 years, 20 years. So the cycles are less pronounced in the mutual funds, in the insurance space, even though some of it may be ULIP business. ULIPs in a market downturn may see a fall in fresh sales, but existing policies will continue, existing money will keep coming in. Whereas in the AMC business, although it's a growth business, but you could see a scenario where assets under management would fall 20-30-40% in a bad cycle. So one is the value of existing units go down because of market fall, not because of redemption. And on top of that, you could have redemption coming in. So the AUM of funds in 2008-2009 will be half of that in 2007, because market fell by half plus there were some redemptions, which is not probably the case as much with the insurance business. Again, in mutual fund, a lot of money may come by lump sum. In insurance, lump sum is a single premium policy. SIP is your regular insurance because where you are committing to pay yearly. Mutual fund SIP can be stopped at will. Insurance, you keep paying premium. Again, AMCs, people look at returns every 3 months, 6 months. Oh, your fund is doing well, his fund is not doing well, or vice versa. Keep shifting from one player to the other, one scheme to the other. In insurance, all those kind of things don't happen so much. Again, insurance may not be as bad a business as banking because typically they guarantee a very low rate of return to policyholders, which can be achieved without taking too much risk. Bulk of the money can go into government securities or very highly rated PSU and corporate bonds, some of it in equity. So even a player like LIC can go on buying PSU bank after PSU bank and still probably survive for some time and service its policyholders. So insurance companies don't take as much risk on the asset side as banks. So typically the problems that we have seen in, let's say, in the banking space where huge NPAs get reported and things like that, those kind of risks typically should not be there in the insurance space. So we are looking at accounting of insurance companies on a non-technical basis, as I said. The technical part we had covered in the first presentation. As we have discussed, life insurance contracts are long-dated contracts. To get someone to sign up as a policyholder takes a lot of advertising, commissions, marketing effort. All of those expenses are hitting the P&L in year one. The day the policy is signed, or even if the policy is not signed, whatever money you have spent, you have to expense it out. Apart from this, so in the insurance company, if you pay 100 rupees as premium to the insurance company, 100 rupees is not income for the insurance company, because against that 100, they have to pay you some money in the future. Out of that 100, they have to keep aside part of it to meet future liabilities. So only a portion of it can go to that P&L in any particular year. So how much goes to P&L and how much is earmarked for future liabilities? That depends on IRDA guidelines and assumptions. These guidelines are very, very conservative. They force insurance companies to keep aside more money than required so that there is safety for policyholders. As a consequence, for all life insurance companies, initial years there are losses reported or profits are underreported, because all marketing expenses, all commissions are expensed year one, and plus most of the premium income in the earlier years is kept aside for meeting future liabilities. As the policy matures, as the policy progresses, you have more money coming into shareholders' P&L account. So insurance company, insurance business is a business with losses and low profits in the initial years and hidden reserves in their balance sheets. So that's why in HDFC Standard Life, I said, don't take the net worth figure as correct, don't take the return on equity as correct, because net worth would be underreported, even profits would be underreported. How to value insurance companies? We will take a look as we go along. So given these problems with insurance company accounting, there is something called embedded value calculation that insurance companies do. What is embedded value? Let us say you have written 100 policies. Each insurance company, with their actuarial department, with their auditors, outside actuaries, they put in assumptions saying 100 policies are there, how many people will die in what period, how many policies will lapse, what will be future expenses, what will be future returns on these funds. And after doing all those calculations, they come out with a number saying the present value of all these policies today for shareholders is this, which is nothing but what a stock analyst would do as DCF for any company. A stock analyst will do discounted cash flow analysis saying year one cash flow will be this much, year two will be this much, and so on. And they discount it to the present value and they say DCF value for this company is 100, stock price is at 90, so it's attractive. Embedded value is nothing but DCF analysis. Only difference, or the big difference between embedded value calculation and DCF as is done for normal stocks, is embedded value analysis is only done on policies in force today, policies which have already been sold. It does not take into account future growth. You have sold 100 policies. This is the embedded value of those 100 policies. Every year you are selling 20 more policies, we will not take value of those future sales into account. We will take into account all the sales have happened from past till 31st March 2018 and give you this one number saying embedded value of this insurance company in terms of its future profits discounted to the present value is this amount. That's the difference. When valuing insurance companies, the embedded value gives you the value of policies already sold. You add value of policies which will be sold in the future. You add the two, you get an estimate of value of the company. So essentially, all the SIPs for the insurance company which are already in force are in the DCF. All the premiums that will be paid from now to the future on policies already sold are accounted for in embedded value. Future sales are not accounted for. So let's take one company just to get a feel for how this is happening. We have already seen the value of this company, market cap of this company is 94,600 crores, right? The reported profit after tax for March 2018 was 1,107 crores. So in a typical company, we would do price earning ratio. So is the price earning ratio of this company 85.5 times? No, that is not the right metric. As we have seen, in insurance companies, initial years profits are underreported. So any growing insurance company will have some negative impact on P&L from the sales which are being done today or from the early stage insurance policies. So this is not the right metric to look at. You cannot value insurance companies on price earning ratio basis. The reported net worth of HDFC Standard Life Insurance is 4,735 crores. But typically in banks or NBFCs, people calculate price to book. Is price to book of 20 times, is price to book the right metric? That is again not the right metric to value insurance companies, because book value is underreported. And again, insurance work, accounting works differently. The book value which is reported today is this because a lot of actual profits have been segregated for future liabilities. More contingencies are provided for. Also, all the marketing and commissions have been upfronted, the benefits of which will come in the future. So you cannot say that it's 20 times price to book and it's overvalued. This is again not the right metric. The embedded value as reported in the annual report, and again calculated by actuaries and auditors and all that, is 15,220 crores. So this is a relevant metric to value insurance companies. So based on this, you can say price to embedded value or Indian embedded value is 6.22 times for HDFC standard life insurance. Now, we have already seen that the embedded value is the DCF value for policies currently in force. So this is 1x embedded value. If you remove 1x embedded value from 6.22, it leaves 5.22x embedded value for future growth. So when you are splitting the market cap of HDFC Standard Life, you are paying 15,220 crores for policies they have sold up to 31st March 2018. And the remaining 80,000 roughly crores, you are paying for future growth of HDFC Standard Life. That's the mental picture to look at. What should this number be to value a company? In mature markets, it can be anywhere 1 to 2 embedded value. So, mature business would be 1, 1.5, 2 kind of thing. We will look at what's the scenario in the Indian context. We have taken three companies here: HDFC Standard Life, Prudential ICICI Life Insurance, SBI Life Insurance. Market cap, embedded value, price to embedded value. So HDFC Standard Life is 6.22, Prudential ICICI is 2.73, SBI Life is 3.5. All of these companies got listed sometime in the recent past or not so recent past. HDFC IPO price was 290, currently ruling at 472, 334, 356, 700, 657. So these two haven't done much since listing. One is slightly above IPO price, one is in fact below IPO price. Multiples here are lower than what is there for HDFC Standard Life. So I'm not giving any stock buy sell hold recommendations, just making one broad point. As a bank, it makes a lot of difference how you lend in terms of whether you are a HDFC bank or a ICICI bank. If one has done only retail lending, high quality retail lending, or versus someone else has done corporate lending and is currently facing NPA problems, then there would be a dramatic difference in outcomes for the bank shareholders. Insurance companies, investments are more or less regulation driven. A lot of them are in sovereign paper, government securities. A lot of them are in highly rated corporate bonds, equity investments. I don't think the outcomes for policyholders and shareholders would be that dramatic for these kind of wild variations. But again, who knows? Maybe one company will grow much faster than the others. I don't know. But at least this is what the numbers are telling us. Luckily for us, or at least to get some indications, the FDI regulations in India were changed. Earlier, a smaller percentage holding was allowed to foreign players. Then they increased that limit, because of which a lot of foreign partners increased their stakes in the Indian companies. Now, we have some indication as to at what valuations those transactions happened. So typically those have been in this range, 3x to 3.5x embedded value. Again, it would differ from company to company. This is just a general ballpark for the Indian markets. Since Indian market is a growth market, underpenetrated market, saying 1x embedded value, you are never going to get these businesses at 1x embedded value. So how much should you pay as a multiple of embedded value? It would differ from company to company. Does it have a good brand? Does it have a distribution network? How fast it is scaling? All of those factors. And then one has to arrive at some judgment in what to pay for the businesses. So thank you. Happy to take questions.
Thank you, Rajiv, for explaining the insurance business. So the first question is, when this embedded value, because the metric to look for is embedded value, and there are various assumptions that goes in deriving this embedded value. So these assumptions are decided by the company, or there is some guidelines by IRDA, because that assumption itself can change the embedded value a lot.
Sure. So these assumptions are given in notes to accounts of those companies, and broadly they would be in a particular range. They wouldn't be all over the place. There is a mixture of market data, regulation, and the company's own experience. So what is market data? Market data is things like yield on 10-year government bonds. That is market data. What is industry data? Mortality tables are industry data. What is company experience? Company's experience may be above or below the industry mortality. Their expenses ratio may be above or below the industry. Their persistency rates may be above or below the. So some of the inputs may be varying from the industry, but you can go into notes to accounts, look at those assumptions and see whether those are realistic or not. Also, as time goes by, you can compare the assumptions that the company has made with their own experience. So if 3 years back they had made a certain assumption and later on that assumption turned out to be very conservative or very aggressive, then you will know that this company typically does this kind of thing. But again, since today's talk is not that technical, we are not doing a deep dive into it. But if you look at yield assumptions, if you look at mortality assumptions and expenses and persistency, I think these four, if you broadly look at, you should have a clear idea of whether they are realistic or not. Details of how these affect embedded value calculations are partly given in that last presentation. Also, I think HDFC Securities had a good research report which was published on insurance companies. So if any of you are clients of HDFC Securities and you have that report, you may want to read that report.
Hi Rajiv, do you see any disruptions in this industry in the future? You know, like maybe something coming online, doing away with the agents and focusing on pure life insurance. Do you think that could come in the future and disrupt the whole line?
Sure. It's already there. Most companies have online term plans. You can go to the company website, fill in your name, contact details, age, gender, the kind of cover required. They'll give you probably a broad estimate of the premium which you would have to pay. They may ask you to do a health checkup or someone will call you. Those things are already there. the premium on those policies is less and the coverage is high. So although some people are aware of this and are taking that, it doesn't move the needle too much for the insurance company and the sector as a whole. Bulk of the premiums are coming in the unit linked and the traditional policies, because the agents and the insurance companies are interested in pushing that more. It's more lucrative for them. So as financial literacy grows, maybe those will pick up. But for now, I don't see that changing in any meaningful way in the next 3 to 5 years is my guess.
Banks, we have this situation that capital dilution is required for every incremental growth. We have a similar principle even in insurance companies.
There would be some retained earnings for insurance companies. Again, as time goes by, some of the hidden reserves will start reflecting as actual reserves on balance sheet. So some amount of growth can be self-sustained, but if the company grows too fast, capital raising may be required. So there is something called solvency ratio. Just like in banks, there's capital adequacy ratio. In insurance companies, there's solvency ratio and required capital and all. So they have to increase their net worth as their business grows. At what frequency will dilution be required? I'm not that certain saying they can grow 20% without dilution. Beyond that, they may require. So I don't have that kind of a precise number. But some growth can be self-sustained. Beyond a certain level of growth, they would have to raise fresh capital.
Just one more question. On the embedded value, if we can look at historical numbers and understand, let's say in case of HDFC Standard Life, how has the embedded value grown over the years? And can we link it with any of the company-oriented growth parameter as well?
So all those are there. I haven't dived into some of those details. So you have the embedded value numbers given across the years. They give you year-on-year growth rates. They give you 5-year CAGRs, all of that. So if you open the annual report, you will get those numbers. Also, again, some people are so one-time embedded value is the value of past business. 5.22 is the value for future growth. So some brokerage report, I have seen this ratio, they take this as the numerator and they divide it by value of new business in a one particular year. So they compare new business growth with this excess that you are paying over embedded value and try and compare that and all of that. So there are various ways of slicing it and dicing it, and there is some amount of variation in terms of how different analysts look at the business. I deliberately have kept some of those parameters out because one, it becomes somewhat more technical, and second, there is no consensus and it's somewhat early in terms of which would be the right parameter. But broadly, 1x embedded value is what is here and now. Anything over and above that is value for future growth, and then you have to calibrate it.
Hi Rajiv.
Hi.
Thanks for the presentation. It was very lucid and clear. I wanted to ask you two questions. One, do you see the intensity of competition increasing because now with Policy Bazaar and these various apps that are coming, it's very easy to compare different policies, the rates they're offering. So, one, is the intensity increasing? And two, can you give some idea on how one should look at the general insurance business? So,
sure.
Thanks.
General insurance, it's a whole presentation, so it's maybe we'll have one full session on that. General insurance is very, very different from what we have discussed today. That's an annual contract. So this year, if you have car insurance from one player, next year you can go to another player. Every 12 months, that contract resets. If you have existing health insurance, you can take a new one from someone else. So we'll discuss general insurance separately. Competitive intensity in some products like pure term insurance may be yes, because you can clearly compare. But the beauty of life insurance, whether for good or bad, they deliberately make it difficult to compare, number one, because of the product design, and number two, it's sold on emotions. It's not sold on rational parameters. See, what happens is, the moment, or at least some portion of the population, the moment someone recommends a mutual fund scheme to them, they'll go to Morningstar or Value Research or Money Control or wherever. They'll see past 1 year return, 3 year return, 5 year return, star rankings, this, that. Insurance is sar utha ke jiyo, effectively. And it's not a product which is bought, it is a product which is sold. Someone has to hard sell it. So, from fintech perspective, all these players get funded, and obviously they serve a need in terms of there is a set of savvy people who compare things. But this paisa bazaar or would be more useful to compare, let's say, mortgage loan rates across lenders, or would be more useful in comparing term insurance rates. But some of these endowment products or ULIPs and all, they sell on emotion. An agent actually physically sits, comes and sits in your home or office, and unless you give a check, they won't go, and all those kind of things. So it's a hard sell product, which it's very difficult to disrupt by a online thing. That's my take. Only time will tell whether it gets disrupted or competitive intensity takes over or not. Again, given that it's a long duration contract, and that is one, and second, people compare based on claim experience, how easy it is to get money when you actually need it for health insurance, or when someone dies, how soon they settle your claim. So some of these intangibles and brand values come into effect. People don't go purely on the numbers or rates quoted. So anybody's guess. Yeah.
Going back historically, in insurance, the biggest attraction used to be the float capital, which keeps growing year on year. People pay the premium, then the payout is lesser than what comes in, kind of thing. Now, you showed the valuation of three companies, and how they invest their money, how relevant is that? I mean, you read about LIC picking up 51% in IDBI Bank, and all kinds of transactions which don't go down well with me, at least. But how do you see that as a differentiator in these companies?
Sure. So, actually, when we think about insurance, firstly we think about Warren Buffett, Berkshire Hathaway, float. Float is relevant in general insurance more. And Berkshire is essentially a general insurance company. Geico, the super cat insurance that Ajit Jain writes and all that. Where on claims and premium, it's more or less matching. They don't earn too much of underwriting profit, but they make money on the float. In life insurance is to an extent a different activity. It's not a float business in that sense, because those money get segregated as policyholders' funds. How they invest their money is relevant to a large extent to their policyholders. So, if the investments are done badly, the bonus that is declared will suffer. They will be, for participating policies and for ULIPs, they will give lower returns. So, if there are two different insurance companies. If one insurance company is investing well and the other insurance company is not investing well, one company will be able to pay out better returns, the other company will pay poorly. That is relevant as far as policyholders are able to compare and they are able to act on it. Currently, no one has any idea what return they have realized. They are not able to calculate in the first place. Even if they were able to calculate, they can't port their policies. So if I am a LIC policyholder in a with-profit policy, for example, and if I am unhappy with their investments, can I move to another insurance company? No. So it will play out only over the very, very long term. Near term, it may not have so much of an impact.
Thank you for this presentation. There was a thing in the middle where you mentioned about how 50% of the policies kind of
lapse.
Yeah, lapse. They just choose not to pay. Now that is a very big number because 50% of everything is just gone. So what happens, is that calculated in the embedded value, number one? And number two, do they have a competitive, like size, does it have anything to do with how you can kind of keep it going? Because obviously, I mean, like do they have any advantage, the different companies, or?
So, what happens to the lapsed policies? There are guidelines governing each kind of policy. Obviously, there are term insurance policies, there are traditional policies, there are ULIPs. So, each policy will have some rules governing surrender. So, if a policyholder comes and says, I want to surrender my policy, some money is to be paid out to that policyholder. In case of term policy, it lapses. There is nothing to be paid out. So each kind of policy will have different consequences, and IRDA has guidelines governing how these are to be treated in terms of payout to policyholders as well as accounting for the insurance company. This thing has been highlighted in the media. This has been a big problem in the past, so IRDA has try to address it in some way. So one is they have restructured the commissions to make it more even, or to not upfront everything and to gradually pace it out so that renewals happen. They try and take ECS mandate so that the money is directly debited to the customer's account, and those kind of things they try and work out, but finally the policyholder has to keep paying. There's nothing much beyond that.
What I meant is also that, like HDFC, SBI, Max, for example, do they have, is there any difference in the competitive advantage they'll hold in terms of keeping the policies?
I would not think so. I would think no more in terms of has the policy been explained properly or not. A person with sound financial means typically will renew the policy. A person who's been hard sold a policy but who has problems meeting month-to-month or year-to-year cash flows may choose not to renew it if some other pressing financial need comes up. So there would be various factors playing into persistency rather than just the size of the company issuing the policy. But I don't think, as far as persistency ratio goes, LIC will have an advantage over Max, for example. It would typically be something else. Also, if the agent is very closely in touch with the policyholder, let's say a relative or a neighbor or someone who services the policyholder after issuing the policy, then that person will go and collect the renewal check and things like that. But otherwise, it may not. So it would be more of a type of policy, cultural issue, things like that, rather than the size of the company's balance sheet.
It's on.
Yes, Ravi. I'm wondering, you've not mentioned Tata AIG at all. Is it because it's too small?
It's not listed. So these were the listed players. Tata AIA now, but it's not listed.
But are they doing fine?
So given that we are looking at it from investment point of view, I haven't studied their report so much, but my guess would be they would not be doing as well as HDFC, ICICI, SBI, given that Tata's or AIA don't have a banking network. I'm sure they would have some bank assurance perhaps, but yeah, rather than do guesswork, I haven't taken a look at Tata AIA in particular.
My question was, how can we compare the valuation of the Indian life insurance companies to the ones in more developed markets?
You can't.
The price to embedded value is the...
You can't. Because if one company is just growing maybe 2%, 3%, 5%, then the value will be very close to embedded value. Whereas if in some country growth is much higher, then obviously valuations will be different.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And also the question is, if you look at the valuation of the
So practically we have seen that whenever some placement is needed to be done by the government, they are the preferred people to pick up a stake. See, the returns that they guarantee policyholders are anywhere from 4 to 6%. Now if their investments are generating somewhat more than that, they have some leeway to put money. Again, that's a whole separate discussion. Let's not get drawn into that and get distracted. LIC is not a listed player. Let's focus on the listed companies more.
Understanding the listed companies as compared to the term embedded value, which you explained quite clearly, would the term combined ratio be as important, or how to understand that? I'm presuming it's somewhere related to the cost side. How would that work to understand the listed companies?
I think that is more relevant to a general insurance than life insurance.
Okay, thank you.
So, you know, I just, in context of LIC, I wanted to know, do you have an estimate how much profits they will be making?
LIC, I haven't done that deeper study, and again,
I was looking at the perspective of if more and more market share moves to private players, that is the profit pool one can expect in the private space. More share of that.
So, as we have seen, some market share is going each year, so we can over 12 years, market share has gone up by 22%. So, let's say 1.5 to 2% per year market share increase for private sector players, plus the industry growth. You can take that as a rough.
Hi Rajiv, thank you. So I had a couple of questions. So what kind of difference does the product mix make? So like you said, it is kind of insurance, the wrapper of insurance. So, what kind of difference does it make for two players? So, as I understand, I think ICICI is high on ULIP as relative to HDFC and SBI. So, one is that. And another thing is, from what I understand, so when comparing to a bank, say, the loss that you can bear is the permanent loss of capital, which is your money not coming back that you lent. So, in that sense, what kind of risk do insurance companies face? Because a lot of it is reinsured. So, I just want to understand that.
Sure. So, one is statutorily, they are not obliged to give breakup of profitability product-wise, and none of them give. The report that I mentioned, HDFC Securities brokerage report, they have attempted to estimate product-wise profitability. I think you could take a look at that to understand that. What are the risks that insurance companies run? ULIP's risk is to the unit holder. the guaranteed return products or the term insurance products, essentially they have to generate the return that they had estimated while issuing the policy. If investment return crashes, and this was seen in Japan where equity market went into a bear, equities went into a bear market for many, many years, and even on the fixed income securities, rates kept falling and went very close to zero. So whatever assumptions they had made at the time of issuing the insurance contract, those turned out to be optimistic in terms of the return assumptions. Realized returns were much lower. So they fell into trouble. Again, if they buy NCDs and the company defaults, then that affects the company and the shareholders' principal is at risk because they have guaranteed the policy holders. But as I said, the risk is not as much as the banking sector because a lot of it goes into government securities and highly rated corporate bonds. A big portion of the risk is transferred to the policy holders because they are participating policies, participating in the profit. The guaranteed returns are low, about 4 to 6%. So it's not as risky as banking.
So in a rising interest rate scenario, how
insurance companies or their portfolio should do better?
Yes. So again, this portion was covered in the first part. In banks, a rising interest rate scenario will deflate their bond portfolios because existing bonds will lose value. For insurance companies, whenever interest rates increase, their existing bonds will drop in value, but their profitability will ironically increase because the assumptions that they make for future returns and the reinvestment that they are able to do, because these are long dated contracts, the reinvestment rate for them will go up significantly and the achieved returns will be more than the estimated returns. So a rising equity market and rising bond yields, realized returns would somehow be better for insurance companies. And that would,
and Rajiv, in ULIT, because the risk is passed on to the consumers, to the customers. So for a ULIT portfolio, how does an insurance company make money? Do they have a fixed investment management fee that they charge, or?
There are two or three charges that happen. I think one thing they call, again, even a ULIP has an insurance wrapper. So they will, let's say you pay 10,000 rupees as your ULIP premium. Let's say 1,000 goes towards insurance, 9,000 goes towards units. On the units, they will have a fund management charge each year, like AMC charges. They'll have allocation charge, they'll have mortality charge, some three or four expenses are charged to your account, which is the income stream for the insurance company. Great. Thanks a lot, and we can continue questions maybe over dinner.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.